Hello students, today let us study about the topic Bacterial Diseases in Plants under the main subject Agrochemical and Pest Control. Bacteria are single-celled microorganisms generally ranging from 1 to 2 micrometer in size that cannot be seen with the unaided eye. Plant-associated bacteria may be beneficial or detrimental. All plant surfaces have microbes on them termed epiphytes. And some microbes live inside plants termed endophytes. Some are residents and some are transient. Bacteria are among the microbes that successively colonize plants as they mature. Individual bacterial cells cannot be seen without the use of a microscope. However, large populations of bacteria become visible as aggregates in liquid, as biofilms on plants, as viscous suspensions plugging plant vessels, or colonies on petri dishes in the laboratory. For beneficial purposes or as pathogens, populations of 106 colony forming units per milliliter or higher are normally required for bacteria to function as biological control agents or cause infectious disease. Bacterial diseases in plants may affect stems, leaves, roots, or may be carried internally without external symptoms. They can cause a variety of symptoms including cankers, leaf spots, overgrowths, scabs, wilts, and others. These symptoms can be extremely noticeable and recognizable, but they can also be difficult to spot and diagnose. Bacterial infections move from plant to plant quickly, which is why catching the infection early on is important for treatment. It is also imperative that tools be cleaned thoroughly after use on any infected plants, as these tools can serve as a vector for disease. Hence, in this episode, the following aspects are going to be seen. They are types of bacteria that infect plants, survival, dissemination, and host plant interaction of bacterial disease, signs and symptoms of bacterial disease, common bacterial diseases and crops, and finally, management of bacterial diseases. Let us study about these aspects one by one. The first aspect, types of bacteria that infect plants. One of the main types of bacteria that cause plant disease is the proteobacteria. These large groups of bacterial species include bacteria that cause disease in humans, such as Vibrio cholerae, which causes cholera, and Helicobacter pylori, which is associated with stomach ulcers. Some species of proteobacteria live in soil where they fix nitrogen from the air, forming useful compounds that plants use in their growth. One species, Xanthomonas campestris, which affects plants from the Brassica and Arabidopsis groups, causing black rot. The disease symptoms progress from discolored leaves to extensive wilting of all of the stems and leaves, with all the leaves eventually turning yellow. Parts of the plant start to die and rot, and the plant dies completely shortly afterwards. Xanthomonas campestris causes its effects on the plant by producing large amounts of polysaccharides that block the xylem vessels that carry water through the plant. So much is produced that the bacteria is actually grown in culture to obtain these polysaccharides, better known as xanthan gum, a thickener used in the food industry. Some species of mycoplasma-like species of bacteria also cause serious plant diseases. These are bacteria that do not have cell walls, and they are introduced into the phloem tissue of plants by insects such as aphids that suck plant sap. Phloem vessels in plants are part of the transport system for sugars, which are generally moved from the leaves, where they are made by photosynthesis to other parts of the plant, including the roots. Aphids use needle-like mouth parts to puncture plant stems and tap directly into this rich supply of liquid sugar. The mycoplasma bacteria grow inside the aphids and other sap-sucking insects and are then introduced into the plant host by a very effective insect, hypodermic. Plants that produce large amounts of sugar are the worst affected, for example, coconut plants and sugar cane. The overall effect of the infection is to weaken the plant, opening it up to other diseases. The leaves usually lose their color, and another common symptom is green flowers or absence of flowers. Moving on to the second aspect, that is survival, dissemination, and host-plant interaction of bacterial disease. Let us study about them briefly one by one. Survival. Survival of plant pathogenic bacteria in nature occurs most commonly in plant debris left on the soil surface, in and on seeds, in soil, and in association with perennial hosts. But some bacteria can also survive in water, and some do well on inanimate objects or on or inside insects. Clavibacter michiganensis, subspecies Cepedonicus, causative agent of potato ring rot, is notoriously known for surviving on machinery and packaging material. Knowledge of survival is usually essential to intervene in dissemination and for disease management. Next is dissemination. Dissemination of plant pathogenic bacteria is easy, but fortunately, it does not always result in disease. Dissemination commonly occurs by wind-blown soil and sand particles that cause plant wounding, particularly during or after rains or storms. Wounding is essential for entry by many plant pathogens. Aerosols generated by diurnal temperature fluctuations enable dissemination if the temperature and humidity are aligned. Some plant diseases require certain temperature conditions. Example, Pseudomonas syringae with the synonym Pseudomonas sevastoni pathover faziolicola causes disease below 22 degrees centigrade, and Xanthomonas campestris with the synonym Xanthomonas axonopodus pathover faziolae causes disease above 22 degrees centigrade on dry bean Phaseolus vulgaris. Both diseases can occur simultaneously under growth conditions in which day and night temperature differentiates enable disease progression in susceptible plants. Infested or infected seed or any plant part can be sources of bacterial inoculum. Machinery, clothing, packing material, and water can also disseminate pathogens, as can insects and birds. Continual monoculture in an area will usually enable increase in inoculum, making it easier for pathogens to be disseminated. Next is host-pathogen interactions. Infection of plants by bacteria can occur in multiple ways. Infection is generally considered to be passive, that is, accidental, although a few cases of plant chemoattractants have been reported. Bacteria can be sucked into a plant through natural plant openings such as stomata, hydatodes, or lenticels. They can enter through abrasions or wounds on leaves, stems, or roots, or through placement by specific feeding insects. The nutrient conditions in plants may be such as to favor multiplication in different plant parts, example, flowers or roots. Wind-driven rain-carrying inoculum can be highly effective. Artificially, bacteria are most commonly introduced into plants by wounding, by pressure-driven aerosols mimicking wind-driven rains, by vacuum infiltration, or by seed immersion into inoculum. The third important aspect, signs and symptoms of bacterial disease. Most plant diseases, around 85%, are caused by fungal or fungal-like organisms. However, other serious diseases of food and feed crops are caused by viral and bacterial organisms. Certain nematodes also cause plant disease. Some plant diseases are classified as abiotic or diseases that are non-infectious and include damage from air pollution, nutritional deficiency or toxicities, and grow under less than optimal conditions. For now, we will look at diseases caused by bacteria. If plant disease is suspected, careful attention to plant appearance can give a good clue regarding the type of pathogen involved. A sign of plant disease is a physical evidence of the pathogen. For example, bacterial canker of stone fruits causes gummosis, a bacterial exudate emerging from the cankers. The thick liquid exudate is primarily composed of bacteria and is a sign of the disease, although the canker itself is composed of plant tissue and it is a symptom. A symptom of plant disease is a visible effect of disease on the plant. Symptoms may include a detectable change in color, shape, or function of the plant as it responds to the pathogen. Bacterial blight symptoms include brown necrotic lesions surrounded by a bright yellow halo at the leaf margin or interior of the leaf on bean plants. You are not actually seeing the disease pathogen, but rather a symptom that is being caused by the pathogen. The fourth important aspect is common bacterial diseases and crops. Here are a few common bacterial diseases of vegetable crops. Let us study about them one by one. Black rot. The causative agent is Xanthomonas campestris, Pathover campestris. They affect brassicas. The symptoms include light brown to yellow V-shaped lesions on the leaf, which become brittle and dry with age. Vein blackening with a necrotic area. The next disease is bacterial canker, and the causative agent is Clavibacter michiganensis, Pathover michiganensis, and it affects tomato, capsicum and chili. The symptoms are seedlings may die and older plants may wilt and die eventually. Older plants have leaves that turn yellow and wilt only on one side. Cankers on stems and fruits are also seen. Tissue inside stems become discolored. The next disease is bacterial soft rot caused by Pseudomonas species and Ervinia species. They affect a wide range of vegetables including lettuce, brassicas, cucurbits, tomato, capsicum, potato, sweet potato, carrots, and herbs. The symptoms include wet, slimy, soft rot that affects any part of the vegetable crop including heads, curds, edible roots, stems, and leaves. They may have a disagreeable odor. The next disease is bacterial leaf spot or bacterial spot. It is caused by Xanthomonas campestris of various strains. They affect a wide range of vegetables including lettuce, cucurbits, tomato, and capsicum. Let us study about the symptoms. Lettuce. In lettuce, large brown to black circular areas that start as small translucent spots, usually on outer leaves. Tomatoes and capsicums show greasy spots on leaves and stems that go from tan to black. The fruits may have circular spots with central scab. In cucurbits, it begins as small water-soaked or greasy spots on underside of leaves with corresponding yellowing on upper side. The fruits may produce light brown ooze from water-soaked markings. The next disease is bacterial wilt, and it is caused by Ralstonia solanacearum. It affects potato, tomato, capsicum, wilting, yellowing and stunting of the plants, but they may wilt rapidly and die without any spotting or yellowing. Vascular tissue appears brown and water soaked. A white ooze appears when pressure is applied to affected tubers or stems. Moving on to the last and the fifth aspect, that is management of bacterial diseases. Bacterial plant pathogens directly enter the host tissue either through natural openings or through wounds. Therefore, it is difficult to manage them. Some of the general principles of managing the bacterial diseases are as follows. Let us study about them one by one. The first principle is exclusion. Exclusion of a disease entry either from a foreign nation or within the country, from a disease to a healthy tract, is an effective measure for avoiding the disease. Quarantine measures are in vogue in several countries. Example of disease managed are citrus canker caused by Xanthomonas campestris pathover citri in United States of America. The second principle is eradication. Eradication is generally carried out for eliminating a well-established pathogen and its host plant, collateral host or insect vectors, and sometimes use of cultural measures for starving out or killing the pathogen. Example of disease managed are, the first, complete destruction of all infected trees was successfully achieved in the citrus canker in Florida, United States of America during 1914 to 1927. Second, pruning of the infected twigs is followed to reduce the inoculums in the orchards for citrus canker. Third, the destruction of volunteer plants and weed host brings down the inoculum level. Example, brown rot of potato caused by Pseudomonas solanacearum. Fourth, the crop residue may be burnt or plowed deep into the soil with watering to ensure decomposition, which is helpful for the pathogens which cannot live saprophytically in the soil. Example, bacterial blight of cotton caused by Xanthomonas campestris pathover malvacearum. Fifth, crop rotation with cereals is advocated for the management of wilt of tobacco caused by Pseudomonas solanacearum. Sixth, the selected application of NPK, that is nitrogen, potassium, phosphorus, particularly low and split doses of nitrogen, helps to reduce the intensity of the bacterial leaf blight of rice caused by Xanthomonas campestris pathover oryzae. Seventh, the control of insects is helpful in reducing the soft rot of vegetables caused by Erwinia species, and the citrus canker caused by Xanthomonas campestris pathover citri. Eighth, the avoidance of cultural mismanagement favorable to disease is important, such as waterlogging in the nurseries against the bacterial leaf blight of rice, flooding or over irrigation in the field. Ninth, the sterilization of the cutting knife by flame or by 0.1% potassium permanganate solution while cutting the potato tuber for sowing is recommended against the potato wilt. 10th, the seed certification programs to raise pathogen-free seeds of bean caused by Xanthomonas campestris pathover campestris are in practice in the United States of America. 11th, elimination of the externally and internally seed-borne pathogen by seed treatment. Example 1, delinting of cotton seed with concentrated sulfuric acid for bacterial blight of cotton. Second example, hot water treatment of cotton seed at 56 degrees centigrade for 10 minutes for bacterial blight of cotton. Third example, soaking of rice seeds in 0.025% streptocyclic solution for leaf streak disease of rice. 12th, when tobacco is immediately grown after maize, there is a considerable reduction in the incidence of Pseudomonas solanacearum on the later host. 13th, there is some prospect of biological control with the application of organic matter in the form of compost and green manure and even inoculation of antibiotic micropropagandism encouraging antagonism by the application of superphosphate, application of phages in seed, plant and soil as well as by inoculating with bacteriocin producing strains. The third principle is plant sanitation. These measures are adopted so as to avoid the disease onset and also to prevent spread. Example 1, removal of dead plant parts from fruit crops and protection of cut surface with suitable bactericides. Example for citrus canker and fire blight of apple. Next example, avoiding injuries to the plant parts at the time of cultural operations and during harvest, transport and storage. The next example, collection and destruction of diseased fallen leaves, balls, etc. for bacterial blight of cotton. The fourth principle is plant protection. These measures are adopted to prevent the onset and subsequent spread of plant diseases. Example, seed treatment of cotton and rice with antibacterial chemicals against bacterial blight and leaf streak diseases respectively. Second example, treatment of vegetative propagation material with bactericides, for example 0.02% streptocycline for 30 minutes treatment of seed tubers of potato against brown rot disease. The next example, foliar sprays with Bodox mixture and copper oxychloride against leaf spots and blights. Next example is foliar sprays of streptomycin sulfate 100 and 500 parts per molar against fire blight of apple and citrus canker. The next important principle is therapy. Penicillin and vancomycin are effective in the disintegration of the crowgall. The application of antibiotics for protection also involves therapy. The bacteriocins have also been demonstrated to be successful against bacterial disease. Example, Agrobacterium radiobacter against crown gall of peach and tomato seedlings caused by Agrobacterium tumefaciens. The next principle is immunization. By screening under artificial epiphytic conditions, resistant sources for bacterial pathogens can be known. Resistant varieties are evolved by selection, breeding, and other methods. The next principle is based on disease forecasting. Plant disease forecasting help in timely and economic management of bacterial diseases. Following basic principles are used for forecasting. They are forecasting by natural infection. This is based on observation of plants at regular intervals both in the nursery as well as in the main field for the occurrence of the disease. The next type of forecasting is forecasting by climatic condition. Effect of various meteorological parameters on the incidence and spread of the disease is studied in detail, and the congenial meteorological parameters for these are worked out. Prediction model is prepared on the basis of these observations. The next forecasting is based on bacteriophage population. A correlation has been obtained between the occurrence of bacteriophage in the field and disease outbreak in the case of bacterial leaf blight of rice. Prior to outbreak of the disease, the phage population in soil and irrigation water increases. It is possible to some extent to forecast the disease outbreak using the phage population as an index. Finally, to conclude with today's topic, it is always best to have a plan of control before the disease occurs. The plan should include use of pathogen-free plant materials and an irrigation system that does not wet the leaves. It is very important to critically examine all new plant materials as they come into the greenhouse. Thank you.